All right, we got ourselves some lore here from Total War Warhammer 3 and both Scrag the Slaughterer and Greasus Goldtooth. Now, Greasus, the blog came out yesterday, and I decided to just kind of put both of these things together, both Greasus and Scrag. So we're going to just go through these blog posts today and talk a little bit about the lore of both. If you've already read the blog posts, you're not going to find out anything new here. And for the most part, this is strictly just a lore blog post. There's not many mechanics or anything of the sort that we'll really talk about. So if that's all you really wanted to know today, like I've said before, I like to upfront the knowledge in my videos. Feel free to just go ahead and shut the video down. I don't mind one bit. But before you do, please don't forget to like, comment, or subscribe if you enjoy the video, or at least this style of format of information. It does help me out a ton. And if you have not yet pre-ordered Total War Warhammer 3, you can do so using the link to my Nexus store in the description. This gets you a Steam key directly from Creative Assembly, and it also is a great way to support the channel. And this is, of course, what's going to get you access to Scrag and Greasus, because those pre-order early adopter bonus, whatever the hell it's going to be, is access to the Ogre Kingdoms. So let's go through both Scrag and Greasus here. And we'll just kind of just read through this together. And really, this is coming from Andy Hall, right? And Andy Hall is the gentleman who's written numbers of tomes of information and knowledge and lore for Games Workshop himself. He's a former Games Workshop alum, so he knows quite a bit. So let's read through this. So the question of how to make an ogre more deadly is not one that is often asked in jest or otherwise. And basically kind of just kind of goes through a little bit about Scrag the Slaughterer and how he, unlike Greasus, relies a little bit more on gorgers. That's kind of his big benefit. And we took a look at the roster, right? And we know that he does directly give benefits to weapon damage, to healing, everything to gorgers on the map themselves when you're in a battle. So we're probably also going to see some bonuses in the campaign that stretch to giving bonuses to gorgers, maybe even giving them a passive regen, all sorts of stuff I would imagine from his actual skill line. Probably stuff like increasing their weapon damage, their recruitment rank, their recruitment cost reduction, stuff like that. The standard fare. And when we compare him to Greasus, Scrag himself is a slaughtermaster, and a slaughtermaster means that he is a caster. That was weird. So he casts gut magic, or the lore of the Great Maw, whatever you'd like to call it. And we've seen that Great Maw in its entirety too. And if you guys are interested in that, I can do videos on all the new Warhammer 3 lores that are coming, as far as lore of the Great Maw, Yin and Yang, and the Lore of Tzeentch, since those are the four that we've seen in the gameplay videos that were given to us from CA. So let me know if you want to see those in the comment section. More than happy just to do a quick rundown video of all those lores for you. But the Lore of Great Maw does have some healing. It's got some leadership penalties. It's got some damage bonuses. It has a direct damage spell. So it's a pretty nice little kit. It's got a lot of things that it can do, and it's pretty nice here. Also, Scrag is the prophet of the Great Maw, so that kind of gives him a little bit more importance. But let's go into these two big paragraphs, because they're pretty important here. So what does he keep in his cauldron? How did he end up like this? And that's the big thing, is that Scrag carries a big cauldron behind him. And as he kind of kills people and eats things and stuff like that, he throws it into the cauldron, and that kind of gives bonuses to the map. And that's the way it was in tabletop too. But Scrag was the head slaughtermaster of Braun Rockgrinder, a tyrant with a notoriously bad temper. While Scrag's role was of a high station, he was tormented by a particularly cruel little Knoblar who happened to be Braun's favored. The Knoblar knew it and thought itself under the tyrant's protection, but it perhaps pushed Scrag too far. He accidentally cooked the irritating Knoblar and served it up on a platter to Braun at a great feast. The tyrant was not amused. In a rage, he hacked off Scrag's hands and devoured them in front of his cheering ogres. He ordered Scrag's pot be attached to the ex-slaughtermaster's back so he could drag his shame about until his dying days. The tyrant was not finished. He banished Scrag to the cursed undercaves of Braun's mountains, where he was led and sealed in. The hungry gorgers that lurked there quickly sensed prey. Scrag wasn't having any of that. He stuck his butcher's tools into his bloody stumps and made short work of the pack that attacked him. From that moment on, the gorgers who survived Scrag were his servants. The pack would soon swell, as if the creatures knew of the carnage and meat that was to come. Scrag finally emerged out of the caves further up the mountain. He had been wandering in the dark for a while and was now convinced the Great Maw was talking to him, guiding him to a great purpose. He came upon Bronze Tribe from above with his pack of gorgers and enacted a bloody revenge, filling his cauldron to the brim, which seemed to greatly please the Great Maw. So, as a player, keep his pot full and the buffs will surely flow, or follow. And I imagine, too, there's going to be some sort of campaign mechanic around this. I know there is the Ogre Campaign Mechanics blog, and this might fall in line with the meat mechanic, might have something to do with that. We might even see a mechanic that is a holdover from the Orcs and Goblins, right? The DLC that came out with them and them having that whole pot that they can contribute to. I'd imagine there's going to be some sort of similar style of mechanic here with Scrag the Slaughterer. So how did Scrag end up quite so far flung from his brethren, and what else can you tell us about him? Scrag is a wanderer with no rhythm or reason, or so it seems. He is led by the Great Maw, which makes him a perfect candidate for the events to come. We meet up with him around the Grey Mountains. So far from the Ogre Kingdoms themselves, but if the Nation of Men are looking to the north, well, that's an opportunity to fill that cauldron up. Scrag has another great voice performance, both horrific and disgusting. We wanted to get across his mania, so you'll find he rarely talks to anyone but the Maw. I liken him to a cross between Rorschach and Gollum.
Gollum's doesn't sound precious.
So that's interesting to see that we're going to actually see him in the Grey Mountains, which is a little bit different, right? We probably might see him maybe near the Ogre Stronghold of Gristle Valley, something that's a little bit further away from the rest of the Ogre Pack. And I think that we're going to see that a lot with the future Ogre possible DLC or Legendary Lores that they add to the game. Like Golgfag himself was a man-eater, and he was not necessarily associated with the Mountains of Morn. He actually spent a lot of time fighting with the dwarfs of Karak-Azul and so on and so forth. So I could actually see more ogres being further and further away from the Mountains of Morn in the further DLCs of Total War Warhammer 3. Well, that just kind of sums up Scrag here. Just a quick little lowdown and dirty of him. I am excited to find out more information about his campaign mechanic. But we also have... Big Daddy Greases here. And you can see I've got the pictures ahead of time, not the actual blog post. So a huge shout out and thank you to Creative Assembly for sending these on over. And if you've already seen the Greases section, like I've said before, I don't mind. Go ahead and head on out. Let's kind of go through this really quick. But so give us the goss on Greases. Goldtooth is what you get when you have an ogre with an insatiable appetite, a singular vision, and the considerable guts to enact it. Before Greases, it had been over a century since the last over-tyrant. No ogre since Donner Gutbag has had the strength of character to pull the fractured tribes together under one kingdom. That all changed with Greases. After stewing his father, we don't know the fate of his siblings, he took over the Goldtooth tribe and its wealth became his. The Goldtooths have always done well compared to the other tribes. Their territory crossed the Ivory Road, one of the few reliable trade routes through the Mountains of Morn between Grand Cathay and the Old World. That's an interesting little point there. Greases' father and all previous tyrants of the tribe had simply destroyed and plundered any caravans they spotted coming through. A good few caravans slipped through, making it a viable concern for brave merchants and their caravan masters. But still, such action was earning the ire of the Celestial Dragon Empire. Not that the Goldtooth tribe cared, they were getting rich off the plunder. When Greases came to power, he could have kept doing what his forebears had, but this ogre was far greedier and more cunning. Instead, through his envoys, he set up a meeting between himself and Zhao Ming at the Tower of Ashashir. The Iron Dragon was speaking on behalf of the Dragon Emperor that day, and Greases made light that they both had difficult relationships with their fathers. While Zhao's retinue gasped at the audacity of this fat creature before them, the Iron Dragon paused, then let out a powerful guffaw, which was quickly joined by Greases' own belly laugh. That day, an informal agreement was made. Cathay's caravans could move through the Goldtooth territory, but a toll must be paid. In one stroke, Greases had ensured that he would get a cut from nearly every caravan that came along the Ivory Road, far more profitable than the ad hoc raids of previous tyrants, and had placated enemies in the east, allowing him to focus on his ambitions within the Ogre Kingdoms. So why that's kind of important here is that's new. We don't have Greases having a rapport, period, with Cathay. In fact, we don't have any kind of relationship with Cathay and outsiders to a huge extent, right? We have they've got an ambassador here in the Empire and in Kislev, but this is pretty huge, right? It creates a relationship between Cathay and the Ogre Kingdoms, and I'm sure they did this as a way to kind of give natural diplomatic allies to Grisus in the Mountains of Morn, which I'm sure he's going to be surrounded by orcs and goblins, Skaven, and I'm assuming chaos of some sort, some way, shape, or form, and then some stand-in, whatever it is going to be, for the chaos dwarfs. So this gives Grisus an actual diplomacy option, and it gives Xiaoming a diplomacy option that is not other Cathayans. Well, the only other Cathayan. And of course, they're also going to be dealing with Skaven as well as chaos. So this makes a lot of sense from a game mechanic standpoint, and I can understand why they would want to do it. Why is Grisus so much more successful at doing what all ogres want to do? Eat, fight, and gain wealth. Greed obviously plays a large part. He is greedier than the average ogre, and for a race whose culture is based around glut, that is saying something. I think it's his audacity to attain that wealth is why his rise was so monumental. We already touched upon this above with his initial dealing with Cathay, but perhaps the moment that his role as overtyrant was fully enshrined was at the Firemouth. The Black Orc warlord Urk Ironskull's Waa was rampaging through the Mountains of Morn. It had knocked aside the ogre tribes in its way and had gathered at the summit of the Firemouth. A clever move by the Black Orc warlord to squat on their mountain god and deliberately goad the remaining ogre tribes. Rather than being upset or outraged, Grisus immediately saw this as an opportunity. He had only recently claimed the title of Overtyrant, dominating most of the tribes local to him, but there were still some further from his grubby reach that remained, shall we say, skeptical. The Waa was a rallying call, a chance for Grisus to cement his rule. Urk Ironskull's mistake was assuming that all ogres acted in their own self-interest. That had been the case for the past century, but now there was Grisus. Oh, that one kind of threw me for a loop. As the vast ogre horde, the largest gathered in decades, climbed the Firemouth, Urk's army was deployed in a way to lure the ogres into a trap. He fully expected the ogres to race towards the open lines, thinking of only their bellies, and then close the jaws of his trap from the flanks. That's the way it would have gone, but as the ogres were readying themselves for the charge, the peaks reverberated with an alarming, an almighty shout, an order as if echoed from the gullet of a sky titan. It was the overtyrant demanding a halt. His shout stopped the ogre charge, overcoming the guts of every ogre present, and in that moment, Grisus was enshrined as the overtyrant. Grisus went on to claim victory at the Firemouth. He reorganized the ogres before Urk could react, and all the beasts of the gathered tribes charged as one and smashed the greenskin lines before the trap could close. There was a great feast afterward, and many ogres developed a taste for orc meat. Yes, tasty. Connoisseur, I would say. So, we still don't know what this is going to be like from a campaign mechanic standpoint. And I would imagine there's probably going to be something in the way of, I guess anything unique about how we imagined him in game. Grisus is an interesting archetype. He may not be a transforming dragon lord, but he has plenty going for him. I didn't want him to come off as overly comical. He is ruthless and a powerful force, so expect to see hints of Baron Harkonnen, Barry the Baptist from Locke, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels. Oh, I'm sorry. Barry the Baptist from Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels, and also De Niro's portrayal of Al Capone in The Untouchables. He's one of my favorite voice performances in the game. The actor has done an excellent job. So, I think that it's really going to be interesting to see how a lot of his mechanics probably come in. You know, we know about big names. We know about the feasts. We know about the meat mechanics and all this. But I'm really curious to see if he has some sort of, like, not intrigue, but has some sort of diplomatic pull, or he has to do something where he's constantly vying for the attention or the approval. That sounds weird, like he's looking for validation. But I mean, he probably has to do something where he's quelling other ogre tribes to bring them in line or something of the sort. So I could see something that is not necessarily like the Empire and their electric count system, but something of the sort where it brings in multiple heads, multiple tyrants of other tribes, and you have to do things to make sure they stay in line. I would be interested to see if that's kind of the role that Grisus has, which is really not the kind of role you would expect for an ogre, but I do like that, right? It is different. It's not just like they said right here, right? It's not just eat, fight, and gain wealth, right? It is those things, but by doing it through like kind of a little bit of subterfuge or maybe some political intrigue, which you would not expect in the Ogre Kingdom, which I think would be cool, but who knows what will happen. But that pretty much covers everything here today, guys. Just wanted to quickly go through these quick little lore blogs for Grisus and Scrag. If you have any questions, go ahead and let me know in the comment section below. You've probably seen the Ogre and the Cathay and the Tzeentch and the corn stuff that has been just spewing out everywhere. I've covered both of those, I'm sorry, all four of those rosters in the respective streams that we did those battles in. But if you have any questions specific, like, hey, you know, I didn't catch that, what is the lore of Great Maw about, so on and so forth. And if you do want to see all four of those lores in their own video, go ahead and let me know in the comment section below too, and I'll get that done for you guys. But as always, thank you so much for watching here today. Have a good one, and take care.